before the Maker when we die.
Amen.
Well, I'm going to ask the deans today. Now, I'm not going to try to preach today, because how can you preach at that moment that Scott stepped into last night? He stepped into a moment last night, didn't he?
Amen.
For those of you who are here. I've never heard a message like that on potential and destiny. I preach a message called Destination and Destiny. And I got a lot of material for that message last night when Scott preached. And there is a difference between your destiny and your destination. They're not the same. You see. Your destination is paid for. There's nothing you can do to add to your destination if you're a true believer and not a make believer. Say true believer.
True believer.
Not a make believer.
Amen.
You will go to your destination. You will be with Jesus wherever he is. That's guaranteed. Amen. The Bible said we are sealed with the Holy Spirit until the day of redemption. When Paul said he shall change our vile body into a body like into his glorious body. That is a guarantee.
Yeah.
There is nothing I can add to that. Jesus said it is finished, and that's exactly what he meant. Your salvation is based upon your belief, not your behavior. Amen?
Hallelujah.
And if you're a true believer and you believe right, you'll behave right.
Right.
Salvation was based upon belief. If salvation was based upon behavior, the Mormons would be the most saved people going. Because the Mormons probably behave a lot better than charismatic and Pentecostals. Their value system is pretty good. But their belief system is warped. Okay, the Jehovah's Witnesses belief system is warped. You see, salvation is based upon belief, not performance, not behavior. If you believe right, you behave right. If you believe right, you behave wrong, you won't behave wrong long. But you'll keep short records of God, amen? Because the Holy Spirit will convict you, you'll repent, get on with the business, quit wallowing around the mire and whining and whimpering. But no, you just get up. Dust yourself off and get on with it, amen. Get over yourself and go on with it, amen.
Hallelujah.
Our salvation is secure.
Yeah.
But your destiny, you have a part to play. Your destiny is not guaranteed. Your destination is. Your destiny is not guaranteed. Your destination is. You have a part to play in your destiny. So I got a lot of material last night from Scott when he talked about that potential seed is in itself. Praise the Lord for that.
Amen.
But Scott wants me to teach on the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You say, well, I'm already filled with the Holy Spirit. But can you take so much in Scripture, you know, not your Pentecostal denomination's explanation of it, but can you take some points in Scripture as a spiritual vision and lead them into the baptism of the Holy Spirit with no confusion? You see, we as men of God, we need to be leading people out there in a public place that we lead to the Lord, into the mighty baptism of the Holy Spirit. You see, so that's the baptism that we're going to dwell on today. There's a lot of controversy over baptism. People, most denominational churches only believe that there's one baptism. But the Bible says there's four baptisms. There's four baptisms. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 says, for by one Spirit were you all baptized into one body, we've all been made to drink of one Spirit. Now, who is the agent baptizing us into the body of Christ? Of course, according to that scripture, the Holy Spirit is the agent that places us and baptizes us into a body of Christ. That's your salvation experience. Jesus said, there's one standing here among you who's mightier than I. I'm not wearing the pious laces. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Now who's the agent that's doing the baptizing there? It's Jesus. Jesus baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire. Now there was one who said that, John the Baptist. He was out there at the River Jordan baptizing him to the sin of repentance. Who was the agent doing the baptizing? The baptizing in water. John the Baptist was the agent doing the baptizing. It could be the bigger pastor is the one who places you in water for water baptism. So you have the baptism into the body, which is the Holy Spirit, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, places us into, that's your salvation experience. You have your baptism in water. Okay, when we get born again, we want to follow God, and we used to be baptized in water. We're going to take the plunge. Amen. You baptize a sinner, you just come to know what sin. You got to be qualified to be baptized in water. Amen. So there's a water baptism. Then there is the baptism in the Holy Ghost that Jesus Christ is the baptizer. So that's three. But Jesus told James and John, I have a baptism to be baptized with. Can you drink it? He was talking about the baptism of sufferings, wasn't he? The baptism of sufferings. So there's four baptisms there. In Ephesians, it says that we are endeavored to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace, because it's one Lord, one faith, one God, one what?
Baptism.
Well, I said there was four. But Ephesians said that there's one baptism. Yes, there's one baptism that is necessary for us to get on with our brothers and sisters, whether they be Baptist, Nazarene, Lutheran, Presbyterian, whatever they may be. If they're born again, washed in the blood of Jesus, there's only one baptism that is necessary for us being brothers and sisters in the Lord. And that's the baptism of 1 Corinthians chapter 12, saying, for by one Spirit, where we're all baptized into one body. And we've all been made to drink, all of us, regardless of denomination, we've all been made to drink of that self-same one Spirit. Amen? So in Ephesians, when it talks about endeavoring to keep the unity, there's one baptism. That's the baptism into the body of Christ. That's the new birth, the born again experience, where the Holy Spirit places you into the body of Christ. That's all we need to have unity. Someone doesn't have to speak in tongues for me to have unity with them. You understand? If someone gets sprinkled, I can have unity with them. Because that's not the baptism necessary for unity. You understand? The baptism required for unity is the new birth. Before we split hairs or any doctrines with our brothers and sisters, we got to make sure that every chain of the devil is broken. You understand? Praise the Lord. Thank you for your enthusiasm.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to talk about the baptism of the Holy Spirit here. The one that Jesus Christ baptized with. We're going to start off here in John chapter 14. We'll talk here, isn't it? John chapter 14. This was before Jesus Christ died. And of course, before he died, it was before he rose. And he's having a talk with the disciples here and the people that are with him here. And he's given some instruction about that there is going to be another comforter that will be sent. But first, he had to go away. Because if he did not go away, the other comforter, just like himself, would not come. But if he did go away, he would come. Praise the Lord. And John, if you're there in your Bible, John 14, this is my first, I gave this a very years ago, and I wanted to look at this out of this Bible, because I still have my notes from 30-something years ago here. And they're just as good today as they were when I pinned them in there, praise God.
Amen.
Amen. Say how many good Bibles you use, Bible.
Come on.
Praise the Lord. Say dust on the Bible, drop in the heart. Come on. Say dust on the Bible.
Dust on the Bible.
Drop in the heart.
Drop in the heart.
Now it's dust on the iPad. Dust on the iPhone. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. But here I'm reading out the scriptures today. I like the way Randy Rogers and read out the scriptures this morning. I love the way Scott is. Randy, people said, Randy, you just opened your Bible this morning. Well, you must have quoted 200 scriptures this morning.
Amen.
So, oh, you didn't open this Bible. Well, you got that much Bible in you. You don't have to go through every page. about a time. It's not about a capsule. God doesn't want a capsule.
Yeah.
He doesn't want a piece of a pizza. Amen. He wants it all.
Mm.
Amen. Yeah. They all in.
Oh, amen.
Those who like Texas Hold'em. No, I don't play Texas Hold'em. But I would hope to think that I'm all in. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. But here, starting out, we're going to see the threefold experience of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit before you got saved, the Holy Spirit when you got saved, and the Holy Spirit after you got saved. Amen?
Right.
It's a threefold experience in the Holy Spirit. Now, in the Greek text, these are all different Greek prepositions, and they mean three different things. But really, in the English grammar, if you know anything about grammar, and I know a little Greek, you know, the restaurant down the street, you know what I'm talking about? And, even in the English language, there are these prepositions that are very obvious in the English language. You don't need the Greek text. But I will tell you the Greek meanings of these prepositions, and you know what they mean? The very same thing the English mean. Very same thing. Jesus speaking with the disciples before he died. Here's what he says. Verse 16 of chapter 14 of the Gospel of John. Big John. Amen? And I will pray the Father. Now, think of something that Jesus said that he would pray the Father here. But you know, after the Holy Ghost was given, Jesus said you would pray. You go over here to John chapter 16, he says, not that I will pray, but in that day that you will pray. And we've got to realize Jesus is not out there doing your praying for you. You understand? That's why he sent the Holy Ghost. You see, he said, in that day I will pray, you will pray. But here he is praying. Because he hasn't died yet. The Holy Ghost hasn't come yet, so he's praying.
Yeah.
But he ain't praying now. The Holy Ghost makes an intercession. We've broken these and others. We've broken the others. We don't know how to pray. But you have to do the praying now. Jesus is there as your high priest. He's there as your mediator. But he's not doing the praying for you up in heaven. People write songs. Jesus is praying for me. No, he's not. That song he writes. He's not praying for us. He's mediating for us. He's our go-between. He's the veil. You know, he is that. His body is the veil now. Praise God. Representing us before God the Father. As our high priest, after the order of Melchizedek, not after the order of Levi, where they have to go every year, once a year, but Jesus is ever living to make intercession for us. Amen?
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You like teaching?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Thank you for your enthusiasm, man.
Yes.
Now, teaching scares a lot of Pentecostals. They're afraid of it. Hallelujah. It's not jerking or shaking or rolling or coming, you know, they don't think it's God. But I want to tell you, you put the teaching with the shake.
Yes, right.
Amen. Amen. You put the teaching with the joy.
Yeah.
You put the teaching with the preaching. Praise
Hallelujah.
The Lord.
Yeah.
Paul said, Lord, will make a preacher, a teacher, and an apostle.
Yeah.
Well, Paul the apostle said, the Lord will make me a teacher, a preacher, and an apostle. Hallelujah. He doesn't replace one with the other. He just adds two. Right. Say, I'm an evangelist. Well, one of God says, well, I want to add something to that. You don't give up the evangelism. You just say, God, add to. You say, praise God, man of God.
Praise God, man.
Hallelujah. Now, here's what he says here. I will pray the Father. Now, if I hear one of these here, that means some sacred cow got shot in the head. Okay? Like, you know, if I hit some sacred cow doctrine, you know, that you made God, sacred God, instead of the Word of God, then this will, then you identify yourself, and you get free, amen? Hallelujah, there's still sacred cows in the church today. They're still making golden calves today from backslidden preachers. You know, it was a backslidden preacher that made that golden calf, you know that? Praise the Lord. Because he was afraid of the people, but he was reverence for the Spirit of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. charge.
Right.
Now, I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another. The word another means just like me. One just like me. He said, I will pray the Father, he shall give you another comforter. That's that word paraclete that Pastor Patty likes so much. Paraclete, one called alongside the helper, that he may abide, circle the word with, that he may abide with you. That he may abide with you forever. Praise the Lord. Now that word with there, okay, comes from the word para. Para. The word para means alongside of. Like I am alongside of this band. This music stand, I'm alongside of it. Jesus said the comforter is alongside of you. You see? I'm alongside. That's where we get our word parable from. Jesus used those stories alongside of the truth to make it more visual for them. And the word para comes from the word parable. The word parable is made up of two words, para, balu. Para means alongside of. Balu means to pitch, toss, or throw. So parable means to throw, pitch, or toss alongside of. And Jesus many times would throw a story alongside of the truth to make it visual for people. He throw it alongside of. So Jesus said that the Holy Spirit is with you, alongside of you. You see that? Now this is before he died. The Holy Spirit was only with them. He cannot be in them. He was only with them. No man comes to the Father except the Spirit draws him. So before we were born again, the Holy Spirit was wooing us, alongside of us, wooing us to the love of God.
Right.
You see that? This is before he died. No one had the Holy Spirit in them, say in them, before Jesus died.
Right.
And the Holy Spirit would come upon David, Thomas, would come upon him, and he would play a harp and prophesy. It says John the Baptist was filled with the Holy Spirit from the womb. You understand? But no one had the 1 Corinthians chapter 12 experience of the Holy Spirit, the new birth experience, until Jesus Christ died.
Amen.
Everybody believed and were saved by believing that Messiah would come. But no one had the Holy Spirit living inside of them. That's why Jesus said the greatest in God's kingdom is greater than John. I never thought of a greater man that ever been born than John, but the least of you are greater than John. Now talking about the new covenant people, the people that have the Holy Spirit inside of them. So no one had the Holy Spirit in them before Jesus died. He was only alongside of them. Understand? You can amen that.
Amen.
Anybody got any water they want to share? I can use a drink of water. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Joel. Thank you, brother. For by one Spirit we're all baptized in the body of Christ. We all been able to drink out of one bottle.
That's what it means.
Mm-hmm. All we need to drink of one Spirit. Hallelujah. I'm not intimidated by drinking out of the same bottle. A lot of Christians want to drink out of the same fountain. They don't want to drink out of the same fountain. They want to drink out of the Baptist fountain, Church of Christ fountain, Assembly of God fountain, Church of God in Christ fountain, Church of God fountain. Hey, there's only one fountain. The Bible says you have forsaken the fountain of living waters.
Ooh.
You've forgotten me days without number, the Bible says. You have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, but I have not forsaken you, but return it to me.
That's
what the Lord is saying. Return to me the true fountain of living water. It runs real deep, and out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water.
Come on. Mm.
Man's doubt, those stagnant religious doubt, makes you sick.